Next speaker is from Ziauddin Hospital, Dr. Asma Islam. Please.
Thank you so much, Kashif. Thank you, PSA, for inviting me on this important talk, which is very important, not only important, but is very close to the heart of many of us. So my topic is obstetric hemorrhage beyond guidelines. I will try not to go beyond time, but I'll try to cover both the aspects, starting from the guidelines till what is the reality. So in Pakistan, 1 in 89 women, they die because of pregnancy and childbirth-related complications. Pakistan's maternal mortality rate is approximately 300 per 100,000 live births. 20% of the deaths in women of childbearing age are caused by the maternal complications, among which obstetric hemorrhage is the commonest. So when we define massive obstetric hemorrhage, there are many definitions for it, but the most commonest which we use is that the blood loss which is encountered during the birth of the child from the uterus or the genital tract of approximately more than 1.5 liters, with a decrease in the hemoglobin of more than 4 grams per deciliter, and then requiring the acute blood transfusions of more than 4 units of blood or blood products. Now, the blood loss, it can be it can have many reasons, which can be antenatal, which can be during the delivery and postpartum, as well as secondary hemorrhage can also occur. Antepartum hemorrhage occurs after 24 weeks of gestation, but before delivery, and the reasons can be placenta previa, abruptio, or bleeding from vaginal or cervical lesions. However, the postpartum hemorrhage, which occurs after 24 hours of delivery, can persist till 6 weeks of post-delivery. And the most commonest cause are usually uterine atony, retained products, genital tract trauma, and uterine inversion. In Pakistan, there are many case reports, there are many authors, corresponding authors, letters to the author, editors, but there are, we do not have guidelines proper on proper guidelines on that, which have been made so far. जो अभी तक सबसे latest 2018 का cohort में study हुई है, उसमें उन्होंने frequency of the देखी थी obstetric hemorrhage की, जिसमें सबसे ज़्यादा number उन्होंने लिए थे, that was around 4600 deliveries. तो उसमें भी जो postpartum hemorrhage का ratio निकला था in Pakistan, that was the most commonest cause was uterine atony, which was followed by genital tract trauma. And these are the 4 T's which we need to know, that either it can be associated with the tone or with the tissue, trauma, or the traumatic. And there are many causes causes associated with them. But the risk factors secondary to each of them are usually the suspicion of the placenta previa, accreta, increta, or percreta, pre-pregnancy obesity with a BMI of more than 50, clinically significant finding of other bleeding disorders or other significant medical or surgical risk factors can be the by whom we can detect that the patients can have a risk of postpartum hemorrhage. Then at the time of labor, if the patient is giving a history of previous cesarean, difficult cesarean section, or a uterine surgery, or with multiple laparotomies have been done in patients, those patients who have who are multiparous, especially more than 4 children, prior obstetric hemorrhage they have, or multiple myomas, or hematocrit of already having anemia and hematocrit of less than 30, they are at the risk of having hemorrhage. And the high-risk patients can be placenta previa or low-lying anterior placenta, suspected accreta, percreta, with a platelet count of less than 70,000, active bleeding, known coagulopathy, more than 2 of the previous risk factors or previous uterine scars. They increases the risk of postpartum hemorrhage more. Now, the blood loss, it can notoriously be difficult to assess in obstetric bleeds. Bleeding may sometimes be concealed, and the presence of amniotic fluid, it makes the accurate estimation challenging. Obstetric hemorrhage is often sudden, unexpected, and may be associated with coagulopathy. Early recognition and treatment, they are essential to ensure the best outcome. So this was the study which was I was just quoting about the number of the deliveries which we had in Pakistan. So what we do is we usually follow the guidelines which have been made by the other countries, especially American College of Obstetrician and Gynecologist, or Royal College of Obstetrician and Gynecology, RCOGs. And then there are other guidelines which have been made by Canadian Society as well. But if you know that PSA's last newsletter was all about obstetric hemorrhage, and in that Dr. Amin Anwar from LNH, he has written very beautifully about the massive obstetric hemorrhage. उसमें सारी guidelines नहीं है, सारी details हैं how to manage the postpartum hemorrhage. I'm just disclaiming that he has already written that. तो इसमें सारी आपको चीज़ें मिल जाएंगी. तो whatever that the people have so far written or so far the guidelines have said, the most important thing among all of those guidelines is that communication and teamwork are the essential in cases of both anticipated and unanticipated maternal hemorrhage. Always call for help, alert your senior anesthetist beforehand, check and alert the blood transfusion services and hematologists, check and alert the porter service for the transport of the blood samples and the collection of the blood products, check the blood is available, and allocate roles to your team members. This is very important and the essential and the key point. Now, if we come to the management of the anticipated major hemorrhages, these are the recommendations from all of both of American and the British guidelines, that you should have two large bore IV cannula, which you usually have in our obstetric patients. Rapid infusion device or pressure bag should be present in the theater. Blood warming and the warming devices, they should already be present in the theater. Blood should be cross-matched and available whenever there is a need, you can actually get it. Consider preoperative invasive monitoring, which can include arterial line or CVP. Consider cell salvage and interventional radiology. So the goals of the management should be the early identification of the maternal bleed, rapid access to the circulation and infusion of the fluid in the first instance with rapid availability and administration of the warm blood. Then there should be avoidance or limitation of the complications of the massive transfusion, like acid-base disturbance, trolley, hypocalcemia, electrolyte imbalance, and thrombocytopenia. An efficient team working and management with decision-making, it always prevents such kind of mishaps. If there is unanticipated blood obstetric hemorrhage, then you have to do the resuscitation and immediate management, which is the early recognition of the clinical signs. Now, RCOG recommends that the clinicians, they should be aware that the visual estimation of the postpartum hemorrhage or the blood loss is most of the time inaccurate. Why? Because the clinical signs and the symptoms, they should be included. Why? Because of the amniotic fluid and when you are estimating the blood loss. So always start with, as Dr. Hamid said, circulation, airway, breathing, with 100% of oxygen, two large bore IV cannula, call for help, and send blood for the cross-matching. So when the blood, when the hemorrhage is unanticipated, and now you are waiting for the blood products, then start fluid resuscitation with either crystalloid and colloid via rapid infuser or the pressure bag. Rapid infusers, they usually achieve the flow of more than 500 ml per minute, warm fluid flow, till the blood is available, and send the basic labs. The aim should be to avoid hypothermia and to maintain patient's pressures and keeping the patient normal volumic. But at times it becomes difficult. So transfuse blood ideally through fluid warming devices and give group-specific blood if the cross-match blood is not available, O-negative blood is available, or if there is life-threatening bleed is present. So for the major PPH, RCOG recommends that the airway and breathing should be assessed initially along with the evaluation of the circulation and the support of the circulation. Position the patient flat, keep the patient warm, use appropriate measures, transfuse blood as soon as possible, and until the blood is available, infuse up to 3.5 liters of the fluid. And this is the fluid therapy and the blood transfusion chart, which has been taken from the RCOG guidelines, in which the crystalloid should be transfused up to 2 liters of isotonic crystalloid, or if you are giving the colloid up to 1.5 liters. Blood, if immediate transfusion is indicated, give group specific, otherwise O negative blood is not you can give. Then the, what is the difference between the RCOG and the ACOG recommendations? That ACOG, that is the American College of Obstetricians recommendations, they came in 2017, so they are a bit latest as compared to the British, that is Royal College recommendations. The only difference is that the Royal College recommendations, they say that if you have already transfused four packs of pack cells, then and the bleeding is continuous and you don't have the hemostatic measures like PT, INR, so then you can give 4 units of FFPs in such kind of patients if the hemostatic tests are not available. And the platelet concentrates, that is one pool of platelets should be given if there is ongoing blood loss with the platelet count of less than 75 and cryoprecipitates of 2. However, American College says that the ratio should be 6:4:1. 6 of packed cells, 4 FFPs, and 1 platelet count. So always monitor temperature, continuous pulse, saturation, blood pressure monitoring, and respiratory rate, which we all do, Foley's catheter to monitor urine output. These are very small things, but one should monitor, and basically because these guidelines were made by the gynecologist, so they have emphasized more on it. But we as an anesthesiologist, we always, you know, monitor them and we always do these things. So it might not be appearing that we should be doing this, but these are very essential points and are recommended by RCOG guidelines. So they also took the therapeutic goals of British Society of Hematology, as hemoglobin count should be more than 8. Keep their goals were to keep the hemoglobin of more than 8, platelet count of more than 50, PT of less than 1.5, APTT of 1.5, and fibrinogen levels of 2 grams. So when we come to the anesthesia management, general, and we give, most of the time we give regional anesthesia, but in bleeding patients or who are hemodynamically unpatients and coming with the obstetric hemorrhage, then general anesthesia is the choice of anesthesia with rapid sequence induction. Then obviously you have to consider reduced dose of induction agents, preferably ketamine or etomidate, but even if they are not present, you can give small doses of propofol. Regional anesthesia, if it has already been instituted, like epidural, it has already been there, and if the bleeding is controlled, then there is no need to take the catheter out. You can actually proceed with this epidural incito. And if the patient starts getting hemodynamically unstable or if the bleeding persists, then obviously you can have epidural along with general anesthesia. Consider arterial line, central venous pressure, and urinary catheter, but only after definitive treatment has been commenced. That means that you already have 2 wide bore IV cannulas, you have already started fluid resuscitation, and now you are taking the arterial cannula and the CVP, rather than starting on with the central venous, taking the central venous line and forgetting that, you know, the cannulas are there and the patient starts getting hypotensive, and then you will end up being in a mess. So you must not rely on, you must not delay resuscitation or the fluid management. Always use fluid warmers, always aim to keep the patient normothermic. Regular monitoring of hemoglobin levels and coagulations have been recommended by RCOGs, and they also recommend that use near patient devices if available. FFPs, platelet transfusion, cryoprecipitate as needed and depending upon the coagulopathy and the continuous bleeding. And always liaise early with the hematology department for optimal and timely product replacement. So there are no firm criteria for initiating the red cell transfusion. The decision to provide the blood transfusion, it should be based on both clinical and hematological assessment. Blood transfusion or cross-matching should not be used as a negative quality marker and is warranted for certain obstetric events. Severe obstetric hemorrhage, which is requiring more than 4 units of blood products, in those kind of patients, it is necessary to save the life of the mother. So always give blood and do not stop anywhere in between. Once we talk about minimizing the risk and reducing the blood loss, antenatal anemia should always be investigated and treated appropriately, as this may reduce the morbidity which is associated with the postpartum hemorrhage. Uterine massage is of no benefit in the prophylaxis of PPH according to the RCOG guidelines. and they have given it a level of evidence and recommendation A. Then prophylactic ureterotonics, they should be routinely offered in the management of the third stage of labor in all women as they reduces the risk of PPH. So the new recommendations according to the RCOG as well as from the Canadian Society, they say that give 5 units of oxytocin and it can be repeated afterwards, but it should not exceed more than 10, or as in most of the patients, obstetrician forced us to give 10 units and then ask us to repeat it after some time and then again says, okay, repeat it and then give methergine and then, you know, so don't do that and do it according to the guidelines and the protocol. Prophylactic ureterotonics should be routinely offered in the management of the third stage of the labor in all women as it reduces the risk of PPH. So it is recommended, but not in higher doses. It does higher doses of oxytocin is unlikely to be of benefit. Consider systemic hemostatic agents, vitamin K and tranexamic acid, as well as recombinant factor 7. So RCOG recommends that 1 to 1 gram or 500 milligram of tranexamic acid given in women who were delivering had 400 to 500 ml less loss of blood after deliveries as compared to those who did not receive it. Likewise, and they have given it a recommendation level B. Likewise, factor 7, there was lack of adequate evidence, but they also have recommended that it comes in good practice. So there were a lot of research done on recombinant factor 7. There was one time that people used to say they don't use it. Then there came a time, Dr. Saeeda Kibis pe bahut extensive research thi Pakistan mein, Karachi mein, Dr. Shamsi ke saath milke ki thi ma'am ne. Aur usme phir yahi tha ke it actually saved lives. And we have seen such patients in surgical ICU of civil hospital that the patients survived. So it is, RCOG says that there is lack of evidence, but at the same time, they also said that it comes in a good practice. So they have actually marked it as tick point. And if the patient is, after all these measures, because of massive hemorrhage, profound hypovolemic shock, amniotic fluid embolism, is going into cardiovascular collapse, then obviously you have to mobilize additional resources, like you have to involve other teams as well. You have to start doing ACLS and the BLS, and simultaneously aggressive blood transfusions are required. And obviously obstetric team has to take an immediate action to open the patient, like do hysterectomy or whatever. And post-operative management, in the post-operative management, it's not that the surgery has been done, surgery has been completed, the bleeding has been controlled, now you leave the patient. Determine the disposition of the patient beforehand. Transfer to either high dependency unit or intensive care facility depending upon anticipation, your anticipation of coagulopathy and blood loss. Always debrief with the whole of the obstetric team to the patient and the family and always document it. Now the American College of Obstetrician and Gynecologist key elements were 4 R's. It was recognition and prevention, starting from the risk assessment from the antepartum period till the labor delivery and intrapartum, as well as postpartum. Then readiness of every unit, obtain massive blood transfusion, MTP, activate MTP, that is massive transfusion protocol, depending upon the circumstances of your institute or hospitals. And that's where they have recommended the use of blood products at six pack cells, 4 FFPs and 1 platelet, mega platelet. Then respond to every hemorrhage aggressively and report it, document it. So these were the guidelines. And I was asked to talk about beyond guidelines. ये तो बहुत अच्छी अच्छी बातें हो गई जो कि हम बहुत अच्छे 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 सेटअप्स में कर लेते हैं कराची में कर लेते हैं लेकिन हकीकत ये है जो आपको नजर आ रहा है. In this picture you can see कि सब चीज़ें बिखरी हुई हैं, 2 tables लगी हुई हैं, ऑपरेटिंग थिएटर है लेकिन पीछे कोई मॉनिटर नहीं है, कोई एनेस्थीजिया मशीन नहीं है. दूसरी पिक्चर ये शो कर रही है, ये पाकिस्तान ही है. इसमें आप देख सकते हैं कि ओटी के अंदर लोगों ने स्क्रब्स भी नहीं पहने हुए. स्टरिलिटी के हालात आप देख लें, पीछे एक मशीन टाइप की कोई चीज़ रखी हुई है यहाँ पे, लेकिन वो एनेस्थीजिया मशीन है, कोई और मशीन है, वी डोंट नो. और फिर उसके बाद तीसरी पिक्चर ये है कि जिसमें प्रॉब्ली एनेस्थेटिस्ट खड़ा हुआ है या एनेस्थीजिया टेक्नीशियन खड़ा हुआ है, लेकिन रेगुलर कपड़ों में खड़ा हुआ है. पेशेंट आप देख सकते हैं, उसका हाथ नज़र आ रहा है और एक बैग भी लगा हुआ है तो प्रॉब्ली एनेस्थीसिया मशीन से कनेक्टेड भी है बट यू कैन यू नो लुक एट दीज. सो जो रियलिटी है वो इन सारी गाइडलाइंस से दूर है स्पेशली इन सबर्बन एरियाज ऑफ कराची इन सिंध. एंड इफ डॉक्टर हामिद एंड यू नो माय पीएसए टीम अलाउज मी आई कैन शेयर अ स्टोरी कि हमारा एक रेजिडेंट था जो कि क्वेटा में मस्तूम से 80 किलोमीटर्स अवे से आया. तो उसने हमारे पास ज़ियाउद्दीन में डिप्लोमा किया एंड देन ही वाज ट्राइंग टू गिव हिज एफसीपीएस इन एनेस्थीसिया बट ही वेंट बैक टू हिज ओन सिटी भी नहीं ये जो गांव टाइप की जगह होती है. तो उसका एम बहुत अच्छा था कि हमारे एरिया में कोई भी नहीं है. तो द अदर डे ही केम टू सी अस. जब वो आया है तो ही वाज टेलिंग अस हिज स्टोरी. हिज स्टोरी वाज के उसके पास एक दिन ऑब्स्टेट्रिशियन पेशेंट भगाती भी लेकर आए विदाउट एनी प्री ऑपरेटिव असेसमेंट डन. पेशेंट का हीमोग्लोबिन था 5. पेशेंट हीमोडायनेमिकली अनस्टेबल हो रही थी एंड शी हैड टू ऑपरेट ऑन हर. जहाँ पे ये काम कर रहे थे वहाँ पे एनेस्थीसिया मशीन नहीं है, सिर्फ वो स्पाइनल देते हैं वहाँ पे. और वहाँ पे जो टेक्नीशियंस हैं वो इस तरह के हैं कि पहले वो एनेस्थीसिया साइड पे सपोर्ट करते हैं, आपको स्पाइनल लगवा देते हैं, उसके बाद वो सर्जिकल साइड पे जाके स्क्रब हो जाते हैं. सो देर वर लैक ऑफ रिसोर्सेज, देर वर लैक ऑफ ट्रेन स्टाफ एज वेल. तो अब इनके पास जनरल एनेस्थीसिया की भी प्रॉपर फैसिलिटी नहीं थी. तो ही व्हेन ही सॉ दैट द पेशेंट इज़ ब्लीडिंग प्रोफ्यूसली एंड द हीमोग्लोबिन इज ऑलरेडी 5 एंड द पेशेंट इज गेटिंग हीमोडायनेमिकली अनस्टेबल, ही इंट्यूबेटेड द पेशेंट एंड द सर्जरी वॉज डन. ब्लीडिंग कंट्रोल हो गई, सारी चीज़ें हो गई. बट द मीन टाइम देर वॉज नो वार्मिंग डिवाइस, देर वर नो प्रेशर बैग्स, द पेशेंट वॉज बींग वेंटिलेटेड ऑन हैंड क्योंकि एनेस्थीसिया मशीन है नहीं, वो कहाँ पर लगाएंगे. एंड देन ऑब्वियसली ही वॉज स्मार्ट इनफ कि फिर उसने कहा कि नहीं ये पेशेंट यहाँ पर मॉनिटर नहीं हो सकता. ही केप्ट द पेशेंट इंट्यूबेटेड एंड देन ही शिफ्टेड इट टू अ टर्शियरी केयर हॉस्पिटल एट अ बिगर सिटी. सो इवेंचुअली द पेशेंट वॉज सेव्ड. अ बिग क्लैप टू हिम कि वो इतनी लिमिटेड रिसोर्सेज के साथ उसने पेशेंट को सेव कर लिया. बट एट दैट टाइम उनके पास ब्लड नहीं था, उनके पास रिसोर्सेज नहीं थी, उनके पास मशीन नहीं थी, उनके पास लोग नहीं थे. और इवन ही वॉज गिविंग ब्लड बाय 20 cc सिरिंज के कैन्यूला उसने ले लिया था. उसके पास सेंट्रल लाइन आर्टेरियल लाइन कुछ भी नहीं था. सो दिस इज़ द रियलिटी इन मोस्ट ऑफ द सेटअप्स आउटसाइड कराची एंड मे बी सम ऑफ द सेटअप्स इन डिस्ट्रिक्ट एरियाज ऑफ कराची. So always learn that even if such kind of patient comes to you and if you are working at a remote area, then never try not to lose the life of the patient as well as save the child's life. Child's life secondary beshak ho sakti hai, lekin mother ki life aap bachayenge to aapne duniya ko bacha liya.